Travis and all these guys sending them guitars, but they come out on stage and they're playing their Les Paul.
And guess who invented it? Mr. Les Paul. Without further ado, let's digress and let's do a deep geek dive, an old guy dive into Les Paul. Hang on one second, let me grab him for you. Oh, this is going to be fun. I love Les Paul. Not only his playing, you know, but his actual what he's done, you know, for recording.
Well, yeah, he was an electronic genius.
Oh, Mary can pick herself.
Mary can pick and sing.
Look at that, Les Paul. Beauty. Oh my god.
Yeah, that's the recording model that he had. I saw that one.
Man.
You know, you almost forget how amazingly talented he was.
Oh my god. Unbelievable. But what a great player, you know?
Great player, great guy. I had a chance to meet him very briefly, albeit he used to play a weekly gig at the Iridium Theater in, you know, like a jazz, little jazz club, kind of downstairs below some of the Broadway places up on 48th and Broadway, right in the middle of, you know, the crap on Broadway, right, you know, with all the strip bars and all, but he played at the Iridium.
What year would you say that was?
It was probably about 15 years ago, maybe 15 years ago or so.
He was pretty up there.
Yeah, oh, he was just maybe a little less than 90 years old. Wow. I think he was like in his late 80s at the time.
And still rocking.
Still rocking. He had a great band.
Guys, rock! That's right.
Oh, yeah. He had this one really young lady playing bass guitar that he recruited out of. You know, she was, you know, we talked a little bit. She reminded me a little bit of Tal Wilkenfeld. She was young from Australia. She must have been all around 20 years old. And just killing it on the bass. But everybody else in the band was an old fart like him. But yeah, I had a chance to meet him because my uncle, who was a professional photographer and pretty well-known one back in his day, had the same manager as Les did. So I was going to go see him at the Iridium, and I told my uncle when he, you know, arranged for us to get to go and just meet him. He shook his hand, spoke to him for a few seconds, and let him go. I didn't want to be a pest. But
Was he still feisty in his old age?
I was, you know, I told somebody, probably every fifth or sixth word out of his mouth was the F-bomb when he was up there
get
on stage.
The
I mean, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but he dropped a lot of F-bombs. He was...
Get the
He had a lot of pizzazz. You know, he doesn't move like he used to, but and a lot of times he would just let the other guys play and he'd just sort of sit there and admire him and you could just see his eyes sparkle.
Wow.
He was great. It was just, you know, being in his presence and, you know, his name is synonymous with music, you know, in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Certainly for us rockers, old guys rocking.
Well, he was a, you know, famous guitarist before he was, you know, building the guitar, you know.
He told a great story. Late. He told a great story when he was playing, in a, you know, there was sort of a big band type of thing. And Bing Crosby was going to sing. And Bing didn't know him from a hole in the wall, nor he Bing, but he wanted to get to know Bing. And, you know, Bing would get up there and sing for rehearsal, but it didn't really take too much notice of anybody in the band except for the band director. So he said, I took my pick and I sort of tossed it up by where the microphone was. So he, you know, Bing saw it, he picked up the pick and he kind of came back and he looked around to see who the guitar player was and handed it to him and he had a chance to introduce himself to Bing Crosby, which for him was a huge thrill.
That's unbelievable.
So he would tell little vignette stories like that, you know, which was just a lot of fun to see.
Oh, man. I could just imagine the stories he must have. And then here he is as a performer, but then as an inventor, the guy freaking invented the multi-track tape machine.
Yeah, multi-track recording, you know, pretty much was one of the guys who sort of helped to invent the electric guitar. I don't know if he officially invented it, but I think he may have. He's you know, he's like a god for guitar players. Les Paul is a god, you know, in that sense.
Didn't he invent some sort of little box he would put on the guitar to make a doubling sound, kind of a thing?
That I don't know, but it wouldn't surprise me because he was an electronic genius. He wasn't just a great guitar player. He was an electronic genius. I think I also may have told the story that, and this is pretty common knowledge to people who know about Les Paul, but when he was in his, I don't know, 20s or so, I guess the mid to late 40s, he was in a really bad car accident. And they didn't have the kind of medical technology back then. And he broke his right arm, his picking, strumming arm. And the doctor said, we either have to take it off or we have to set it at 90 degrees. And he kind of, you know, figured how he sort of holds his hand when he plays. And he says, okay, set it like this. And they set his guitar, his arm rather, at almost 90 degrees. So you ever see him really strumming, he sort of moves from his shoulder or just.
Well, that's interesting. They set his arm.
At 90 degrees so that he can still play the guitar.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, because otherwise, you know, so that he could strum. You know, he uses mostly his wrist, but, you know, if they would have set it straight, for example, he wouldn't never have been able to play the guitar because it didn't bend once it was set.
But, boy, could he pick. That guy could double pick like anybody. I mean.
Oh, he was an incredible guitar player.
So fast, so technical, you know. Really interesting. And later in life, he got into more jazz, I think. You know, he was doing like a lot of rock, even before rockabilly, crooning tunes kind of.
Well, yeah, you know. A lot of those guys, when they learned how to play, they learned jazz first. Or maybe even classical to a certain extent. I know when I first started taking lessons, I was learning classical music. I went to the Brooklyn Conservatory of Music and studied classical music there. But I got some chops out of that, and then one of the teachers finally came in, and she was a jazz teacher. So I had like, you know, about 3 or 4 years there, and 3 of the years was classical, and then the last year was more jazz.
That explains
cool.
A lot. Explains a lot about you. You know, jazz is such a great foundation, and God, these kids are so lucky nowadays to have YouTube. Because there is so much out there to teach. I'm learning every day. I found a new piano guy named Piano by Johnny. J-O-N-N-Y. It's unbelievable. He was going through modes yesterday. But he'll start like with a simple thing about modal scales but over majors. And then gets more complex. And then, I mean, it was unbelievable. And at the end of it, it was like Bill Evans. You know, it was so sick. But it's all out there, and these kids have access, and they're coming out. I mean, at 15 years old, they're freaking monsters. Thank God, you know, because music was suffering for a long time.
It's also really just a good way to learn how, you know, to learn a little nuance. Like, you know, a song, for example, like a James Taylor song, Fire and Rain, which sounds like a pretty simple song. But James Taylor is a brilliant finger picker and plays with, you know, just those tiny little sort of 16ths in there where ding, you know, where you just don't quite hear it. So I wanted to see the intro to Fire and Rain, which you know, I figure I could just pick up the guitar and just start playing it, but I wanted the nuance. And, you know, type in Google how to play the intro to Fire and Rain. 5 guys will show you, 4 of them completely blow it. And one guy's got it just spot on. It's like, this is great.
Yeah, you got to search it out, but it's out there, you know, and it's really revitalized musicianship in general, I think. And even with this channel here, the reason we even launched this was I was coming west, you know, to move out here to LA, and I was at my old guitar player's house at Old Denny in Chattanooga, and we're sitting around bullshitting like we are now, and his daughter, Madison's 20 years old. We're like an hour and a half listening to us, and we're jamming, and you know, we're having a little fun and trying to relive the old days. She goes, you know, you guys should do a podcast because this is fascinating. I go, fascinating? I thought you'd be bored out of your mind. She goes, yo, you have no idea. People in our generation, we really want to know about that era, because it is a fantastic. You think about the 70s and 60s. And just
of course.
And the social change, and then the musical change from, you know, I mean, it came such a long way in that, of just those 20, 30 years. It was unbelievable. And it's,
you know, I feel blessed that we got a chance to sort of go through the 60s and 70s when rock and roll was really, really taking off. I mean, obviously there's great music that came out yesterday.
Amazing stuff.
But back in the 60s and 70s, that music, you put on any radio station, you still hear it.
And it was revolutionary. There was nothing. I mean, think about Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, groups like that in the 70s, King Crimson, oh my God.
Those are guys who all studied classical music right out of the gate.
See,
right?
And that's exactly our conversation. You know, starting out learning
classical music right out of the gate.
Jazz and classical are such great foundations. But, you know, you still got to rock and roll, baby. And that's a talent. You know, not all guys who are classically trained can jam their way out of a wet paper bag.
So. No, you know, a guy like Eric Clapton never took a guitar lesson in his life. And you know, some songs, there's some of the best songs are 2 and 3 chords. A song I was thinking about, I think somebody posted one of these stupid things on Facebook, you know, name the this and name the that, right? Like, you know, name a song with 2 chords. That was a great song, and it's like
Us and Them
Home by Grand Funk Railroad. 2 chords.
Yeah, right.
You know, 6-7 minute song or something like that. 2 chords.
The simpler, the better. It's like, you know, you look at all the blues masters, you know, Muddy and those guys, and the way they played, it was so heartfelt. You know, I mean,
and just all 1-4-5, 1-4-5 all day long, and God, it just curled your toes.
Robert Johnson. I mean, if you listen to Robert Johnson, go check out my website. I call it the Blues Box. I got a shit ton of blues songs. I got some really good old. I've done a lot of research and I geek out on blues. And anyway, you can play it right from there, stream it right from the site. But that Robert Johnson, wow, you know, that guy, he had more feel in his little, you know, I mean, simple, because he was the original pretty much, you know, who else before Robert Johnson? Not a lot of people, you know.
Not a lot of guys. It's funny. B.B. King has one of these little videos where he shows how he, you know, how he shakes his hand.
Uh-huh.
I mean, and he's got these big giant mitts. And my God, the way he shook his, just the way he shook his hand, and you could hear that, you know, just play an A note for about 10 minutes, and it just had so much color to it.
That's what it's all about, man. Feel is everything. But anyway, that's great, Steve.